We believe in two technologies that are really reshaping today's world that we live in. One is hybrid cloud, and right. The other one is AI.
I'm so jealous because that sounds really exciting. Ah. And you're at the forefront of it, which is amazing and cool.
Yeah, it is pretty exciting.
Hi, Agnes.
Hi, Agnes.
Thank you so much for joining me and welcome to Making the Cut.
Thank you very much for having me. I'm very excited.
Yeah, me too. We're in a great car. Let's go.
Very nice.
Oh,
let's go.
So, Agnes, tell me. Now, IBM has been invested in AI and AI is pretty much your core DNA, right? And yeah. You guys have been working on this for a very, very long time. We've all heard of Watson, and now there's WatsonX.
Yeah.
So tell me, what is IBM's vision with AI?
So basically, what our vision is to help enterprises, organizations, institutions, help the enterprise world to innovate with technology and solve some of their most pressing challenges, whether it's business challenges or societal challenges, with technology. And we believe in two technologies that are really reshaping today's world that we live in. One is hybrid cloud, and right. The other one is AI. And together, we really have now opportunities at our fingertips that make things possible that we haven't had in the sphere of possibility for a right. long time. So this is what IBM and the IBM strategy is all about at the moment, bringing hybrid cloud and bringing AI to clients and to organizations across the world in a way so they can consume it, use it in a safe way and in a way that is transparent and really put it to use in the best possible way. This is what AI is for us.
Excellent. Mm-hmm. Now, I want to talk a little bit about foundation models because that's what you are doing and helping yes. your partners with, right? You have an amazing partnership with NASA as well.
Mm, yes.
And it's a foundation model that you're using, and you're using satellite image.
Yes.
And you are looking at the extreme effects of climate change and environmental changes. And this is going to change the way we solve sustainability issues.
Yeah.
Tell me a little bit about that.
Absolutely. So first of all, foundation models are what basically give, AI a totally different possibility at the moment, right? With the emergence of foundation models, we now have the possibility to put AI use cases into work much faster than previously with the previous generation of AI. And it's really exciting, the various use cases that are out there, but also the various type of models that are out there. And the example with NASA is a beautiful one, I think, from two perspectives, really. One is, I've been talking about using technology to solve some of the most difficult challenges that we are facing. Sustainability yes. definitely is one. And we recently surveyed CEOs across the whole world, and actually nearly 70% of them said, yes, we want to use AI for sustainability. So this is really a use case that allows us to do that. And it's also a good example that, the idea we have of foundation models, of generative AI, it's not just about large language models. There is different types of models. And this is a geospatial model that we have developed together with NASA, who have, a massive amount of satellite data, sensor data. And together we've trained that model, and we can, for example, see how the use of land is changing, where is carbon being, stored, how is, the population moving around. We can use it for agricultural purposes. So it really allows to use the massive amount of data that is available, but it was hardly consumable because the technology wasn't there. And now with AI and that foundation model, we can tap into this vast amount of data that is available from a geophysical point of view and, use it in order to basically advance our recognition as to what we need to do in it in order to be more sustainable, but use it also in, for a business point of view, for example, in the agricultural or the consumer space. So there's a variety of things that we can do with it. I think it's, if you ask me, one of my most favorite use cases.
Yeah, I think space is the next frontier, right?
There's so much space technology that we can use to help with sustainability issues and all that. And you guys are in the heart of it, so it's really amazing,
right?
Yeah, understanding our planet also better, right? I mean, there is so much details we find out about just, all the land that we have surrounding ourselves. I mean, there's so much data that we can use in order to drive better decisions, again, from a sustainability and from a business point of view.
Yeah.
It's not, you know, it's not mutually exclusive. That's the best thing. That's the thing, right? I mean, you're going to be able to help cities, countries. You're going to be able to help farmers as well.
Absolutely, yeah.
And because you can really kind of pinpoint it down to the individuals as well, right? How the crops or the agricultural changes can affect them.
Absolutely. And I mean, also topics like disaster relief. I mean, we are now here in a part of the world. You know, if you look at Southeast Asia, you know, look at countries like Philippines or Indonesia. I mean, there's really a lot of climate change that impacts also the safety of people, of companies, of you know, communities, and yeah, you know, this helps us also to plan for different type of disaster relief. So there's so many possible benefits of it that we can use, and you know, it's a model that's pre-trained and it can be adapted even further.
Wow!
And with this, you know, it's a great use case of generative AI and foundation models at work. You have one model that you can use in many, many ways. Now, because we're, you know, sitting in this very luxurious VM that we are, even with the IBM model, I mean, they have been upgrading their manufacturing using AI, right? And in the USA, in their plant, Spartanburg, they manufacture, check this out, 1,500 BMWs.
Wow,
okay, that is a lot, right? And obviously there is the use of AI, where what happens is that the AI makes sure that a million metal studs are placed on these like beautiful SUVs in the right areas, and they're like these 26 cameras that are part of the entire production line, and they will spot if there's any mistakes that happen or if there's anything that you need to flag up to
humans that run the hood, right?
So, you know, before this, you did talk about foundational model, right? And so let's think about it from a business and a productivity point of view. How will it help to accentuate productivity, automate tasks and in that area? And if we just look at a couple of examples that we do see a lot of focus on in the organizations that we work with, they're also usually falling into these categories of, you know, trying to basically automate and, you know, get rid of, to some extent, workflows, processes that are very tedious or very complicated. Now, BMW has been a long-time advocate of responsible AI, and yeah, this word responsible is becoming very important in the world, right? So, for example, they have these seven principles, and one of it is to looking at human agency and oversight, you know, saying that there is a certain implementing appropriate amount of human monitoring for decisions made by AI applications, and also considering ways where humans can overrule algorithmic decisions, right? Now, that is almost like a post. Let's talk about responsible AI design in this state as well. And which I would say both are more important, but of course, let's hear from the technologists, which is, are they both equally important? Or what is something that we need to focus a little bit more on? I think, first of all, it's important that we talk about responsible and ethical AI. And I'm really glad that you bring this up. I'm glad that BMW has, you know, put so much emphasis and importance on that, that one as well. Because we are at this, you know, topic for a long time already. We've been talking about it, and it's really good to see now that there's a lot of awareness, you know, rising, and people are really spending time on understanding what does it mean, and decision makers really, really spend on time on understanding how they can actually put it into action. And I think both kinds of type of actions are important. Having a, you know, a framework as to what does it mean to have responsible AI, what is responsible AI, what are the principles that we should adhere to, is important. And the other element, how do we actually design AI that is responsible by nature, is important too. And you can't have just one of it. So, you know, we from IBM, we have five principles, not seven, but, you know, they are very, very important to us. It needs, you know, the outcome of AI needs to be explainable. So explainability is a key one. Transparency, if you're interacting with some piece of technology as a human being, you should know that there is actually, you know, AI at work here. Over vastness, you should be able to rely on the outcome. You know, we have heard and talked so much about hallucinations. Robustness is really, really key. Privacy, that, you know, the data that is being used to train AI, but then also, you know, in a workflow, needs to be super, you know, super secure. And that's a key concern that many CEOs have as well. How can they make sure that
data privacy is being held up. And the other one is fairness, right? We've talked a lot about how do we make sure that the outcome of an AI decision, for example, you know, if you look at the banking space, whether somebody does get a loan or not, how do you make sure that there is fairness? I'm so glad I get to interview a woman on the show. A woman technologist, a woman in STEM. And I think that's so important as well when we talk about biases in AI, right? Because it's also the data set that you have for the AI then to take over, right? And as a gender element, right? The biases of recognizing that that's what you need in order for AI to be equally represented. Absolutely. And I mean, the lack of bias or the need for fairness, also that part needs to be handled through both principles that you have as a company that either develops this type of technologies or uses that type of technologies or both, but also needs to be built in into the technology, right? And so this is a key element that we want to make sure, is done by us as well, that we don't only have, a great representation of different parts of the society when we develop the technology, but then we also provide the toolkit that allows companies to test, do we have a drift in our model? Do we have a bias? Yeah. Like regularly, really look at it like a life cycle management overall and really actively search for any problems that might be with the fairness principle in the technology itself. So I think it's really, really important. You have the principles, on the technology company side, you have the teams, you have diverse teams to actually work on the technology, and you can test for any issues in terms of bias and drift.
So since we're kind of still on the topic of ethics, right? Let's talk about whether or not AI should be allowed in regulatory and ethical decisions. Because where does it stop, right?
Yeah.
So should AI be allowed into this realm?
Well, I believe, and IBM believes at large as well, in regulation that is very precise. So precision regulation is the term that we use. And, AI is at work and will be at work in so many different use cases with different risks involved. In fact, just give you an example, right? If you use an AI-powered chatbot that gives you recommendations on which restaurant to go to, is there really a big risk then? Probably not. Do you need regulation? Probably not that much. But if we think about, dealing with employees of a company or, using AI in healthcare, medical environments,
absolutely
driverless cars, right? Absolutely risk involved and there should be regulation there. But being precise in the regulation in line with the risk that we actually have from AI, I think that's really important to have the balance, right? To have, a use of AI that's actually bringing up trust in people, but then also allows to really use AI in innovative ways and doesn't stifle innovation. I think those two things need to kind of be given.
So like for small companies or even individuals thinking about like, how does this affect me? Like, how should I get onto this bandwagon? What is your advice?
I think it's, first of all, onto the technology industry to create trust with individuals, with owners of small and medium enterprises, right? We can see a lot of benefit in the technology. I mean, you can feel it, hear my excitement probably, right?
Yes.
But it will only happen if there's trust in individuals and in, society at large. So it's obviously up to us in the technology industry and, the government and everybody to kind of create that trust. But then I think it's about really getting the skill to understand why is AI actually changing the world? What is it about? I just always say everybody, it doesn't matter what role you're in or role you play in your life, read up on AI, be educated, build the skills for yourself so you actually know what you're dealing with from, understanding the maybe pitfalls or what you maybe don't wanna see, but also seeing the opportunities. But I think there's really possibilities for everybody out there, not just university students, to tap into the possibilities and the responsibilities that come with AI.
The possibilities and the responsibilities.
Yeah, I like that.
And I think that's such a great way to end this conversation. Agnes, I'm so grateful. I mean, I really feel your enthusiasm. And today it's all about the possibilities and responsibilities.
That's a great way.
This is quite AI. I mean, right? The possibilities that brings to the world, but reminding ourselves as human beings, we have responsibility over it.
It goes together.
Thanks so much.
Thank you very much.
Such a pleasure having you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Pleasure as well.